Tennessee Marching Band. Nearly 300 strong, the pride of the Southland is under the direction of Dr. W.J. Julian, assisted by Associate Director James Spark and Assistant Director Ms. Pat Root. Drum major is Mr. Chris Satterfeld. Let's enjoy him. Representing the University of Tennessee, which is making its first Fiesta Bowl appearance, the handsome band in dramatic uniforms of black, orange, and white is a proud organization steeped in tradition. They have marched in every presidential inaugural parade since President Kennedy. Their music, Rocky Top, is the official school song for the University of Tennessee Volunteers.
Warmed up for the big game.
The big game, yeah.
Degrees at kickoff. And 5 minutes ago, Joe Paterno and the Penn State Nittany Lions arriving here at the stadium. And then, Todd, they came out and they walked the field behind us, something that we normally don't see, and that is the entire ball club coming out and walking the field. You were a bit surprised with that, weren't you?
Very interesting ritual. I was wondering about that. You know, I know the players are very superstitious, but every single player came out here. It reminded me of what Raymond Barry used to do when he was a player, just to check all the nooks and crannies to get whatever edge he could.
Right. Tennessee and Penn State. Tennessee led by Johnny Majors.
Well, you know what? He goes clear back to 1956 in terms of his storied career as a player and as a coach. Heisman runner-up in 1956, SEC Player of the Year twice, national championship with Pittsburgh in 1976, and only three losing seasons in 15 with Tennessee. Five straight bowl victories, so he's ready to put on a good show today.
And, of course, on the other side of the field, and I think it's all right to call the man a legend, and that is Joe Paterno of Penn State, and it was here on this field 5 years ago that he won the national championship.
You're not overstating when you say a legend. Fourth on the all-time list of Division I-A coaches in terms of victories, and he too loves it here in Tempe. And the Fiesta Bowl, Penn State is 4-0, so they're looking forward to playing today.
And the Penn State uniforms, always a story. As you know, they're very plain. At the luncheon 2 days ago, I said, are you ever going to change the uniforms? And Joe Paterno said, no. Oh. All right, back to Gail.
All right, Shirley, thank you very much. You know, when Majors was at Pitt, he and Joe Paterno had a pretty heated rivalry, and some people said actually there was a lot of animosity there. Do you think any of that, I know they respect each other, but do you think any of that carries over with them?
Not with Joe Paterno, I don't think with Majors either, but Joe Paterno, he does not play another coach. He gets his guys ready to play another team. Doesn't make any difference who's coaching them. Could be you.
Could be a chimpanzee coaching the other team.
Well,
there you go. Coming up after the Fiesta Bowl, it's the game that will decide the national champion.
Players taking the field today, the Fiesta Bowl will be a highlight in their football lives. A player just gets so many chances to strut on the stage of a bowl game and to savor its youthful pleasures. New faces will replace them soon enough. In contrast, the men who will coach them today return to the spotlight year after year, and few in their profession can equal their tenure or success. Johnny Majors' first bowl game came in 1956 when, as a player, he led Tennessee to the Sugar Bowl and was runner-up to Paul Hornung for the Heisman Trophy. 20 years later, he would coach a Heisman Trophy winner, Tony Dorsett at Pitt. That team went undefeated and sealed the national championship with a Sugar Bowl victory over Georgia. The following year, Majors returned to his native Tennessee and has been there ever since, taking the Volunteers to the postseason 10 times. Only four coaches have ever won more bowl games than Johnny Majors, and one of them will face him today. Nothing has come to symbolize Penn State more than Joe Paterno. He's paced its sidelines for more than four decades as an assistant and head coach. So many great performers have played for him. Franco Harris, Jack Ham, John Cappelletti, Kurt Warner, Shane Conlon. Paterno has been to and won more bowl games than any coach except the legendary Bear Bryant. Two of those triumphs gave Penn State national championships, the last one coming here at the Fiesta Bowl in 1987. So today, these two veteran warriors will be going head-to-head in the 21st Fiesta Bowl. The 21st Fiesta Bowl, the Penn State Nittany Lions and the Tennessee Volunteers. Happy New Year, everybody. This is Charlie Jones along with Todd Christensen. 21st Fiesta Bowl. But Todd, today the magic number is 5.
The magic number is 5. Tennessee has won 5 straight bowl games, and this is the 5th appearance for Penn State here in the Fiesta Bowl. The previous 4 were victories, so they've got a chance to go undefeated today. Something has got to give.
Penn State won the toss. They deferred to the second half, and so Tennessee will be receiving the opening kickoff. Coming into the ball game, Penn State with a record of the regular season of 10-2. They are ranked 6th in the country. Tennessee's record is 9-2, and they are ranked 10th. Penn State is 6th. Tennessee is 10th. Not an advantage, disadvantage to receive in a ball game.
Well, I can understand what their thinking was. Evidently, Penn State is pretty confident in their defense that they can stop people. I think, you know, one of the things that's an advantage to being defense first is that you have had nearly a month layoff. And so, inevitably, what happens there is that the defenses are able to stay sharp, but the offenses are not. So I'm sure that's what Joe Paterno's thinking is here in deferring to the second half.
Greg Fayak will be kicking off for Penn State. Dale Carter, who led the nation in kickoff returns last year, is the deep back. It at the 1. He fumbles it again. There's a scramble for the ball. Penn State has it. Jeff Kerwin with the fumble recovery.
Well, he just misses it. It goes right between his hands. I don't know if it's the gloves or the wind or whatever. And right there, he made a big mistake the second time around. At that point, don't try and pick it up and run. Just fall on the ball. Costly mistake by the All-American.
And there to leap on it was Jeff Kerwin, number 41. The Nittany Lions have the ball just outside of the 10-yard line of Tennessee.
There you can see right there, 42-20 in a turnover ratio, first in the nation. Penn State, a very opportunistic team.
Saka hands off to Anderson, and he goes to the 7-yard line. Now let's go down to Ahmad Rashad. Ahmad?
All right, Charlie, as you stand in that end zone and look towards the ball coming your way, it's obvious that the ball got caught up in the sun. As you look this way, you're looking right into the sun, so I'm sure that was one of the reasons why I wasn't able to field that ball. Charlie?
All right, thank you, Ahmad. We'll be checking in throughout the ball game with Ahmad working the sideline here at the 21st Fiesta Bowl. Second down and 7, the ball at the 7-yard line. Sam Gash is the remaining back. McDuffie and Ingram, the wide receivers, and Saka is dropped back at the 10-yard line. It'll go for a loss of 3. It's going to be 3rd down and 10. Darrell Hardy makes the defensive play for Tennessee. The offensive line for Penn State, Pickett, Jarek, Harry Smith did not draw the starting assignment. He has that shoulder problem. It's McDuffie and Bobby Ingram in the ballgame at the beginning. 3rd down, 10-yard line. Play action fake. Saka has pressure, drops it over the middle to Gash. Touchdown, Penn State. And so the Nittany Lions capitalizing on the fumble recovery. On the opening kickoff, takes the early lead.
A delay route by the fullback. Watch the fullback come to your right screen. Look like he's blocking. Now all of a sudden, sneak into the backfield. The linebacker, number 45, Sean Walker, bit the fake and wasn't able to get over in time to knock down Gash. Good job of play acting there on the part of Gash to get open for the touchdown.
And the extra point is up, and it is good by Craig Fayak. And the score is Penn State 7 and Tennessee nothing. Welcome back to the 21st Fiesta Bowl, and the man who scored the touchdown, Sam Gash. Here's another look.
Take a look at
what. And that means that Fayak for Penn State will be kicking off, and Dale Carter again is the return man. Interestingly enough, this is the phase of the game that Joe Paterno was so worried about, the returning of this man, Dale Carter. And you can see he's shading his eyes. He's looking directly into the sun. You can also tell from the shadows on the field. And, of course, Ahmad told us about that.
And he takes this one a yard deep in the end zone. He's now out to the 10. A little cut. He threw it to 20, the 25. Comes over the top of the 30, the 32-yard line. That's the reason, with that return of Dale Carter, some 34 yards, that you can see why Penn State was so worried. Mark Graham making the tackle. Offensively, for Tennessee, it'll be Daphne, Mislinski, Fisher, Stoll, and Lenore on that offensive line, with Kelly, Brunson, Stewart, Faulkner, Pickens, and Adams, the backs and receivers. So Tennessee, their first time on offense, starting now from their own 34-yard line, first down, and they trail in the ballgame by a score of 7-0. Andy Kelly is the quarterback. And Tennessee opens up throwing, going to their strength. With the fumble, Corey Fleming is the man who pulled it in. Lee Rubin was there for the defense. So Tennessee opening with four wide receivers as they fire through the air.
Well, right off the bat, they went in kind of a zone coverage. Keith Gauganis there has to, that's a mismatch. You can't have an inside linebacker on a wide receiver, and Kelly makes a nice touch pass. And fortunate for the Vols that ball bounced right back up into Fleming's chest.
A gain of 23 yards on the play and a first down for Tennessee. And here they come again. The quick out far side. And it is going to be complete at the 36-yard line. Humphreys had the coverage on McCleskey. Second down and four after that gain of six to the 36-yard line. With pressure, the pass is incomplete. Fleming, the intended receiver for Tennessee. Are you surprised that they came out throwing?
I tell you what, Andy Kelly is obviously not intimidated by the fact that the Penn State defense had 15 interceptions this season. Excuse me, they had 26 interceptions this season. Very impressive secondary for the Nittany Lions, but evidently Andy Kelly has found that there's some weakness back there that he can exploit, and thus far that's what he's done.
Kelly has hit two out of three in the ball game for 30 yards. It's third down and four. And he sets up again and goes deep down the left side and overthrows Corey Fleming. And Gauganis, the inside linebacker, had picked up the coverage. It'll be fourth down.
Well, he's got something to be discouraged about, but they've got a debate here as to whether or not they're going to, you know, it's kind of a tweener situation here at the 36 because they're going into a very small headwind. So this is four down territory. Tennessee's going to go for it. Nobody can accuse that man of being too conservative, especially with that jacket. Oh, nice play.
Kelly with a little pooch kick. Drops inside the five and will be down. It is touched and goes into the end zone. And it will be a touchback. They'll bring it out to the 20-yard line. And Tennessee had all kinds of opportunities. I believe that was Bernard Daphne.
Big mistake here. You can see all the hands people. They know where it is. Now, why would Daphne have to come in and try and grab it? You've got all your wide receivers there like Faulkner and Pickens. Those are the guys that should touch the ball. Big mistake for the Volunteers. One of the things that Tennessee actually stole a page out of the Denver Bronco book. This is something the Broncos do with John Elway, the pooch punt. Now look, all the hands people are right there. And Daphne, that's unfortunate that he has to come in there. You knew that the ball was going to die right there, and you can see the reaction of Johnny Majors. He can't be too terribly pleased. Oh, goodness. Oh, no.
So Penn State, rather than having the ball at their own 4-yard line, will start from their own 20-yard line first down. Penn State up by a score of 7-0. And Saka comes out throwing. The pass is complete to Richie Anderson. And he is down at the 27-yard line. A gain of seven, so it'll be second down and three.
No,
David Bennett makes the tackle. As we'll check out that defense of Mims, Bradley, they're going to rule it incomplete and bring it back. Surlis and Smith with Hardy, Walker, and Fields, the linebackers. And in that secondary, Lincoln, Miley, Bennett, and Carter. So move it back to the 20-yard line, and it's second down and 10. So now we have all the players set on the stage of the 21st Fiesta Bowl. And we have just over 12 and a half minutes to go opening period, and Penn State out in front by a score of 7-0. Sacker with a screen to Gash, and he drops it. It is incomplete. It will be third down and 10 at the 20-yard line. Ernest Fields was there for Tennessee.
Take a look. You're going to see Anderson out here, tailback in the flank. This is the play that was called back. Watch the bobble here at the end. It appears that he has it. Now watch right there at the bottom. The ball comes out, hits the ground, and that's what the back judge sees. He comes in and correctly rules it incomplete.
Changing that offensive line for Penn State, Mike Heller is now in at the guard slot as Malinowski has come out, and it's third down and 10. Sacker with the play action has pressure, and they bring him down. He's a tough man to bring down. He looks like a linebacker. He is 6'5", and now he weighs in at 230 pounds. He said he's about 5 pounds overweight. Mims and Bradley got him.
Well, the Tennessee seam has been sacking a lot of people this year, and Penn State, now we find out, is no exception. This is the second sack already in the first quarter, and the major problem that the offensive coaches of Penn State told us was the offensive line. There at the bottom, you can see they gave up 39 sacks, the most they have ever done in a season. Consequently, the Vols' strength in the pass rush, you can see, with a single season record of the identical number.
Doug Helkowski will be kicking. Dale Carter is the return man.
Are you a little surprised? Do you realize in these two series we've had one running play?
I am surprised.
Oh,
he sails a beauty. Carter takes it over his shoulder. He drops back to the 30-yard line. Little stutter step back to the 29. Turns around the corner, up the sideline. And he's going to go out at the 38-yard line. 51 yards on the kick. Back in a moment. Welcome back to the Fiesta Bowl.
Charlie, right there, that man is a little bit beleaguered early because of his fumble, but a lot of people don't realize this man is a finalist for the Thorpe Award, awarded to Dale Carter, that is, the best defensive back in the NCAA. And I think, you know, he really made up for it on that last kickoff return, the 35-yarder. I think he's going to be back in sync now.
Play action fake. And the pass is complete far side from Kelly to McCleskey. And now let's go down to Ahmad Rashad.
All right, Charlie. One of the big names in this football game today is Carl Pickens, who's the junior All-American wide receiver for Tennessee. He has opted to not go his senior year to go into the NFL draft. I talked to him about the game and said, what does this game mean to you? He said, well, it is the last time that I'll wear Tennessee orange, and it's also seeing that I don't get a chance to play in the Senior Bowl, my last chance to show people what I can do. He'll be trying to do that during the course of this game. Charlie?
All right, thank you, Mike. Here is Tennessee's first running play. And it is James Little Man Stewart who is the ball carrier. He's going to pick up about 9. It's going to be second down and short as Givens and Rubin were there for Penn State.
Well, in contemporary football nowadays, the pass sets up the run, and here's the delayed draw. You can see the blitz from the inside by Penn State linebackers leaves a gaping hole in the middle, and you were talking about Little Man Stewart, a true freshman who just missed a 1,000-yard season. And when I talked to them about that, I said, don't you want that 1,000-yard season? It's okay if I split up with the other guy just so the team wins. Oh, what a guy.
And Tennessee goes back to the air. It is Pickens down the sideline. And Derek Bonner stopped him. A gain of 19. It was second and 1, and it's first down.
Hey, Ahmad, if you're listening, I don't think he needs the Senior Bowl to prove himself. Take a look at this move after the catch. Simple hitch route. Watch the little funk here. Oh, yes. Just like Ahmad used to do it at the University of Oregon. You got to like this kid Pickens. My guess right here is this is a man who's going to be one of the first 10 picks next year in the draft.
First down, 23-yard line. Looking right, he comes back throwing left, and it's Pickens again. And it has been the aerial attack of Tennessee so far, plus the one fumble, the recovery by Penn State, and the score that has underlined this ballgame.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Comes back with the exact same play, and why not? Pickens is an Otis Taylor-type receiver, 6'3", 200 pounds. The pros just love that kind of size. This is a guy that can go after and get it. And talking to the coaches there, he said, look, this guy's just not a speed guy. He's not just a big guy. He actually has great hands.
Second down and 2. And now the second running play. It's the fullback, Mario Brunson, trying to pick up the short yardage and the first down.
It's an interesting ebb and flow of the momentum, Charlie. Early on, of course, Penn State gets the gift touchdown. Now Tennessee is reasserting themselves. They're getting a little confidence, running off a couple of first downs. If they punch it in the end zone here, it's almost as if the first one didn't exist.
First down at the 11-yard line. Play selection, 2 by ground, 7 by air. Now they come back to the ground.
as Little Man Stewart carries. When we were talking with James, we asked him, where did you get the nickname Little Man? He said, I got it from my daddy when he would bounce me on my knee, on his knee, and say, your daddy's little man, and has stuck with him ever since.
Well, anybody who has nearly 1,000 yards, 938, is no longer a little man in the offense. Unless Humphreys comes up and makes that shoestring tackle, we've got a tie score.
Leonard Humphreys, the best cover man that Penn State has ever had, makes the stop. Tennessee with two tight ends on this offensive set. And a little timing pattern into the corner. And he is out of the end zone. So it'll be third down and four at the five-yard line.
Give credit to Bonner for making good coverage there. It doesn't look like it because he makes the catch, but he knows exactly where the end zone is. He knows he doesn't have that much room. And once the ball goes up, take a look at the feet. He tries to get the left foot down, but it was a good call by the official. The right foot comes up and the left foot goes down. In college football, of course, you only have to have one foot in, but neither foot was down. Good coverage by Bonner, number 35.
Tennessee takes a timeout to score. Penn State 7, Tennessee threatening. 9 minutes and 23 seconds time remaining of the first quarter here in the Fiesta Bowl. Penn State leading 7-0. Tennessee has the ball on the Nittany Lions 5-yard line. It is third down and four. And thus far, Andy Kelly has hit 5 of 8 passes for 68 yards. You look for him to throw here, and you look for him to throw to number 15, Pickens. Instead, he gives to Stewart, and he is going to get to the 1 yard line, which is going to be very close to the first down.
I think he got the first down, Charlie, and that was an excellent call. As you say, everybody would think the predictability of throwing the alley-oop to Pickens a la R.C. Owens, but the handoff to the little man was able to get them the first down, I believe, from this angle.
Brett Wright was the first Penn State defender there, and Derek Bonner the second as the chains come out for the official measurement. They are stretched and down. It is going to be shy by, as you can see, about 2¾ inches.
Look at every single player down there. Everybody's motion we're going for, and that's exactly what they're doing. They're going with their big people.
It is fourth down and inches for the first down. Now, do you go with James Stewart or do you go with the quarterback sneak?
No, I kind of like going with Mario Brunson. Look at the size of that guy who just came in here. He's a bruiser. Got their power eye in there. Well, what they're going to do, my guess, is that they're going to run behind Brunson. Brunson and Campbell, they're two fullbacks, 44 and 29.
And instead, he goes with the quarterback sneak, just trying to lean for that 2¾ inches that he needed. And it is all the positioning of where the football was, and the linesman comes in and marks it.
Charlie, you are absolutely right.
It is an inexact science.
Those are my words exactly. You got in my head. This is such an inexact science. How many times you've seen that happen where the quarterback, you saw by the measurement, what did he need, 2 inches?
Yeah, and
you had to figure that he had to get a little bit of momentum. But then when the guy has to run in, maybe he doesn't run in a straight line. Maybe he weaves a little bit. Maybe he's unsure of where the football is placed.
Stretch down, first down. First down and goal to go.
He actually moves this a football length. Take a look right here. He does get it. Good call by the official.
Which is 11¾ inches.
A lot of times when the official has to sprint in, it's tough to see that angle because there are so many bodies, but that actually was a fairly accurate mark.
This is the 10th play of the drive. And little man over the top has it. James Stewart has the touchdown as Tennessee pulls within one with the extra point to come.
As I mentioned earlier, this touchdown now erases the mistake of Carter earlier. Over the top, that was pretty close, but yes, it was enough for the touchdown. Now if they get the extra point, which this day and age is not exactly automatic anymore, we'll have a tie ball game and the Tennessee right back in it.
Stewart, 4 carries, 19 yards, a touchdown, and Bexford with the extra point, and we are tied at 7 with 8 minutes and 48 seconds of time remaining in the first period. We'll look down on the 21st Fiesta Bowl on an absolutely gorgeous New Year's Day. The temperature 63, and this is the view from the MetLife blimp. And our pilots today are Corky Belger and Hunter Harris. And Snoopy, of course, is watching over all of us. 62 yards of the drive in 10 plays.
You know, you don't realize it, you know, Charlie, because you and I do so much professional football, but I was looking there at James Stewart on the sidelines and realized that when we were talking with him 2-3 days ago, this guy just turned 19. I mean, you have ties that are older than that.
This was my New Year's Day. I just turned 19, yes. Let's go down to Ahmad.
All right, Charlie, the man standing with me now, you probably would recognize him from the movies, from television, but I recognize him because he's got this orange on, and he's had it on ever since he was 13 years old. You told me that Tennessee, this is David Chief, you told me that Tennessee likes to start off behind.
Well, I like us to. We seem to play better when other people jump out to a lead on us, and I like the way we're using the pass to make the run work, so... Maybe they'll kick a field goal, we'll score a touchdown, back and forth all day, and we'll come out on top.
All right, Charlie. You and Charlie, we have all the answers down here. Anytime you need something, Dayton and I will be standing by.
Okay. And on the return, this is Shelley Hammonds to the 40, the 45, and finally Collard at the 47 or the 48-yard line. 42 yards on the return, and Dale Carter got him. Shelley Hammonds, the junior from Barnwell, South Carolina.
Watch him cut back to the left. You're going to see the play is designed to go to the right. Now watch. All of a sudden, he cuts back left, and there's a big gap there. And unless Dale Carter, the 4-4 All-American free safety, is there to get him, then he goes the distance. Dale Carter, number 18, has been involved in a lot of important plays thus far in this game. But Shelley Hammonds gives Penn State excellent field position at the 47-yard line.
So Penn State goes to work first down at their own 47. The ball game now tied 7-7. And coming over the top is Richie Anderson. He is airborne at the 50-yard line.
How many
Chris
times
Mims brought him down.
How many times do you see that? Look at the smile on his face. This is pretty good. I don't know if he's trying to do his Michael Jordan thing and prove that he's got a vertical, but at the 47-yard line, he just takes off. He sees some bodies there. Look at that. I love that. That's great.
And he sails for 5 yards. It'll be second down and 5. The ball at the Tennessee 48-yard line. And here comes the safety blitz. Gash just slips it, but the hole is filled very quickly by Bradley as it was Fletcher who was coming on the safety blitz.
Well, they guessed
and
right
he had
in
a big
situation.
Run, didn't he?
Watch Carter come from the right side. He's going to knife in, and even though he doesn't make the play, he creates enough havoc that Gash has to alter where he's going, and the pursuit's able to catch up to him in the form of 4 or 5 Tennessee tacklers.
So the ball drops back to the Penn State 49-yard line, and it is 3rd down and 8. Sack at the throw, has pressure, and he is dropped at the 45-yard line. 3rd sack for Tennessee. Chuck Smith got this one. And he was ready, but we talked to him a couple of days ago.
Well, the quickness of the Volunteers is really wreaking havoc on the front line of Penn State. Watch him come up the top, just a quick move to the inside, and he gets right past the left tackle there, Paul Siever, for the Penn State Nittany Lions. And as you mentioned, that's the 3rd sack, and we're still only in the first quarter.
And as Chuck Smith was walking away from him, we talked to him after practice a couple of days ago, he turned back and says, by the way, I'm taping the game. Do a good job.
I would say that if we broadcast as well as he's pass rushing, then we'll do a great job.
Here's the kick by Helkowski. Carter's going to take it at the 1-yard line. He does not like the fair catch. He does like the return. He's out across the 20, has to step across a couple of players. Good return of 21 yards on the play. A flag is down. 54 yards on the kick. He managed 20 yards on the return.
Well, that's a lot of trust that the Tennessee coaching staff has in that All-American to let him catch the ball on the 1-yard line, but quite frankly, he had a shot at going the distance. They had an excellent wall set up to the left, and his fake there initially enabled him to get open.
We have a dead ball foul. Personal foul. Then the run back will set the stakes, mark off half the distance, it'll be first down.
We had a bit of a late hit that marred the return of Carter, but it appeared for all intents and purposes that he was heading to the right, then he cuts back to the left. How many times do you tell the guy, you got to let this go, but he feels it at the 1 yard, and now he's coming right. Now, all of a sudden, he bursts back to the left, and they've over-pursued. Now, right here at the 20-yard line, that's an excellent play there by number 21, Shelly Hammonds, who earlier, of course, was the one that made the big return for Penn State. If he doesn't make that tackle, then Carter's got a long ways to run, and they'd have had much better field position.
And, of course, being a dead ball foul, they set the stakes for the first down at the 22-yard line. The line of scrimmage will be back at the 11 when we come back. We are tied at 7. He has the ball at their own 11-yard line, but it is first down and 21. And they have four wide receivers. It is Pickens again, this time across the 15. He'll be down around the 16-yard line as Bonner got him at that point.
You know, Charlie, I'm wondering, you mentioned earlier that the defensive coordinator, Jerry Sandusky, for the Penn State Nittany Lions said that the best cover corner they have ever had is Leonard Humphreys. So my question is, why is Leonard Humphreys on the left side when Carl Pickens is on the other side? Why isn't that man covering him man for man? Why haven't they made the switch?
They did talk about doing that, and when we talked to Humphreys, he said he was all for it, but they wanted to stay with the basic defense that they've been running all year long and not make an exception in this game.
Now, Pickens already has three catches.
Well, they may change their mind. He now has four. Spins loose at the 30 to the 32, 33-yard line. Yoboa Dakota. I knew I'd have problems with that name.
Give Andy Kelly credit here. Pickens makes the fake, but look at him being pursued. Just before he goes down, Eric Rivati almost sacks him, but he gets the ball away. Nice 360 move by the 200-pounder right there to avoid Darren Perry, the hero back, and get some extra yardage for the Volunteers.
From the 16 to the 33-yard line and the first down. And remember, it was first down and 21 back at the 11-yard line. Through the middle, the 40, the 45-yard line. A gain of 12, first down for Tennessee. John Fisher, who told us if bowl games should be fun, the offensive center is the man who opened the hole.
Well, the three-year starter here does a nice job on Ben Fadi, pushing him off the nose tackle, and all then he has to do is he has to beat the linebacker one-on-one, and that's what running backs get paid to do. Stewart having a big first quarter, first down for the Volunteers.
At the Tennessee 45-yard line. Look at that total offense. 4 yards for Penn State, 126 for Tennessee. In case you missed the opening, fumble recovery, Pickens fumble. Penn State got it and scored in three plays. Stewart carries here into Nittany Lion territory. Your boy Cody makes the tackle at the 47-yard line of Penn State.
Charlie, you got to give a lot of credit to Phil Fulmer, the offensive coordinator for Tennessee. They've done a good job of mixing it up, and even though they haven't been running effectively early, because of the passes now to Pickens and to some of the other wideouts for Tennessee, they're starting to exploit the middle of Penn State's defense, and you can tell that they're on their heels. They don't know what's coming, run or pass.
Stewart, 6 carries, 39 yards, and the touchdown. The ball game tied at 7-7. It is second down and 2. Play action. This one is thrown away. Kelly was simply out of time. This is a problem that he has had. Sometimes he's forced it to places that he shouldn't. This time he takes the coach's advice. When you have it, everybody's covered, just get rid of it.
Well, see, now what's happening here is that Jerry Sandusky, the very thing that he was concerned with, is occurring. They're coming up 2nd and 1, 2nd and 2, and now they can go with the play action passes. And as you can see right there from the play action face, that put a lot of heat on the defensive line for Penn State because they don't know what to do. Should we walk back on our heels for the run or should we pass rush? And then when they wait that long to pass rush, as you can see there, Kelly had plenty of time.
Kelly has completed 7 of 11. Double lucky numbers, 90 yards. And here is Stewart for the first down. Keith Koganis with the tackle.
You know, they've had the twin freshmen this year who have totaled over 1,600 yards, but the way the little man Stewart is running, I'm not sure Hayden's going to get his carries. If the whole idea is to go with the man that's hot, then as it looks right now, 33 is the man to get the ball to.
And now Tennessee with three wide receivers on the set. And there wasn't anything left for Stewart as Lou Benfati was simply waiting for him to lose a couple back to the 41.
One of the things that Tennessee has had about the last couple of years, the likes of Reggie Cobb, Chuck Webb, and Tony Thompson, is excellent tailbacks. These two are true freshmen. You can see right there combined for a third of the offense at over 1,600 yards. But right now, that man on the right of your screen, Mr. Stewart, is having himself a day.
Second down and long, four wide receivers for Tennessee. All alone and dropped. Lloyd Kerr drops the ball.
Charlie, they're going to rule it a completion.
They rule it a completion.
This is the play they were able to hit earlier to their wide receiver. And once again, you can see, watch the middle of the field. They go to the zone. He splits the zone. He's all alone there in the middle. They have to do something with regards to that. They can't count on their safeties to just come up with the big hits. You can't let those wide receivers, in this case, Lloyd Kerr, run wide open in the secondary.
My eyes deceive me. I thought he dropped the ball. It is a first down at the 15-yard line. End zone, incomplete. Kelly going to J.J. McCleskey. Humphreys had the coverage. It'll be second down back of the 15-yard line. Let's go down to Ahmad Rashad. Am I?
All right, Charlie. This is a huge game, and here watching it is the Grand Marshal of the Fiesta Bowl Parade, Irma Bombeck. Now, you're on this side.
The grass is always greener over the septic tank, which was a lot of laughs, and the other one was, if life's a bowl of cherries, how come I'm always in the pits?
I mean, and the new one is, when you look like your passport photo, it's time to come home.
She's a very entertaining columnist.
She's a great job.
A very talented writer.
11th play of the drive, third down and three. Kelly, good protect, dumps it off underneath. This one is incomplete. Hayden, the intended receiver, he couldn't hold on to us.
Excellent play there by Lee Rubin. He wasn't even a starter when the season began, and now at the end of the season, he is the leading tackler for the Penn State Nittany Lions, as well as having five interceptions.
And the field goal team is aboard. John Bexford, who is hit from 44 yards out, so Craig Martin is the center. Jason Julian is the holder. Bexford will be kicking from the 14-yard line, an attempt of 24 yards. Good snap, it is down, it is up, and it is good. And Tennessee has the lead by a score of 10-7 with 1:42 left to go in the first period.
Charlie, that's the closest I've seen in this first quarter. You could say that Penn State stopped the Nittany Lions to make them kick a field goal, but if you figure that the young man can hold on to the ball in that instance, they probably go in for the touchdown. I think Jerry Sandusky has to get with his troops and reassess what they're doing, particularly in the secondary. A lot of the zone coverage that they have are getting thwarted by Kelly. And the chess game that always goes on between the offensive coordinator and the defensive coordinator, in this case, Fulmer and Sandusky. Fulmer's winning so far.
Let's go down to Ahmad Rashad.
All right, guys, you guys know that the Fiesta Bowl just doesn't consist of a football game. There have been a lot of various events taking place all week prior to today's game. Among them were yesterday's Fiesta Bowl parade, led by the Grand Marshal, Irma Bombeck, who had the line that it's the first bowl that she's seen that she didn't have to clean. Now, earlier in the week was Fiesta Bowl Ball, which featured the entertainment of multi-talented singer and dancer and also football fanatic Gregory Hines. And football wasn't the only sport involved in the week's festivities. The Fiesta Bowl basketball tournament took place in Tucson, where Arizona, our producer Tommy Roy's alma mater, beat Rutgers in Monday's final. And college football wouldn't be complete without marching bands, as the award-winning high school bands from across the country competed in the Fiesta Bowl pageant.
And the kickoff to Penn State, Shelly Hammonds, it goes through his hands, out of the end zone. The touchback will bring it out to the 20-yard line.
I didn't get a chance to see it, but I understand Gregory Hines put on quite a show.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. He was exceptional. So Penn State now trailing in the ballgame by a score of 10-7, and Todd, they have been unable to generate any kind of offense, and they've had to operate without one of their great wide receivers, Terry Smith. He has shoulder problems, and we're trying to get a complete update on the situation, but that tells the story. 174 yards in total offense to four.
Well, if he is not able to play today, that's going to be a major loss, because that man caught 55 passes for 846 yards and 8 touchdowns. That 55 catches is the most in the history of Penn State for a wide receiver.
Zacha throws the pass, is incomplete. He was going to Richie Anderson. Let's go down to Ahmad.
All right, Charlie, I just spoke with Terry Smith, and he said he will not be playing in the game today because of a shoulder injury that he has sustained. So he's out and won't be a part of this Nittany Lion offense.
Well, that's a big loss, as you were pointing out, John.
Well, that's really a big loss because, as we pointed out earlier, this is the first time in 10 seasons that Penn State has passed more than they have run. And so, you know, integral to the success of their offense has been Terry Smith and O.J. McDuffie, and that's a major loss for Penn State.
Tackle with a play action. Fake pass is incomplete to the tight end, Kyle Brady. And it will be third down and 10 at the 20-yard line.
That man right there has to be a little bit frustrated. He put that one right on the money, and Brady just dropped it. And the way the Penn State offense has been going with only four total yards, they need a break here. They can't afford the luxury of drop passes and mental errors.
Zacha has completed only one of five for 10 yards. That completion was the touchdown to Sam Gadd. When we talked to Joe Paterno, he said he really doesn't call the plays along the sideline, but things are going well. He will take off the offense and call the offensive plays. Gash carries on the draw to the 26-yard line. It's going to be fourth down and four as Ernest Fields makes the tackle, and that means that Elkowski will be kicking to the ever-dangerous Dale Carter.
I'm surprised that with this series that Joe Paterno didn't try to get a running game going instead of throwing on first down all the time. Despite the fact that Penn State does have, Tennessee has excellent pass rushing defensive linemen, they are smaller than the Penn State offensive line, and they should take the opportunity to be physical with them and see what they can do about dominating the line of scrimmage, because right now, it's certainly going in Tennessee's favor.
Elkowski has pressure, gets it off. Carter drifts back, looks into the sun, takes it at the 29. He's to the 30. Good coverage by Penn State. They will stop him around the 31 or 32-yard line. See where they mark it as a tackle. Well, it actually took him back to the 29. It was Brian Mosier who got him. Joe Paterno, when we talked to him, we asked him about the passing game. It hadn't been working, but he said he has a good quarterback in Zacha.
I know we had a big league arm, big league quarterback, and we had wide out.
A new side of Joe Paterno. And here is Stewart carry. And he is able to run free. Picks up 13 yards before the hero Darren Perry makes the tackle. And the run being set up by the pass of Tennessee.
Penn State's defense just really looks flat here. That was simply a dive play, and there's nobody there. Watch the right side of the line. Just a straight hand off to the eye back. The fullback comes in, goes in the middle linebacker, but look at the gaping hole there. No defensive line, no defensive tackle or defensive end to stop his thrust, and there it is again.
And this is Kenneth Campbell. They're going to mark it at the Penn State 46-yard line. A gain of 12, back-to-back first downs. Lee Rubin makes the tackle.
Well, part of the problem, what's happening here, Charlie, is Penn State's inability to go three and out. The momentum is all Tennessee's. They give the ball right back. And here's Tennessee charging again.
Into the first quarter, Tennessee 10, Penn State 7. The statistics after the first period of play.
Well, I guess they tell the story here. Look at that, almost 10 times as many yards. The thing that stands out to me, though, is that 0 yards rushing. Even though Penn State may not be a running team, they've got to establish some semblance of a running game.
But Tennessee Stewart, the leading rusher, with 65 yards and 10 carries. And the play action this time works to Faulkner. And Bonner makes the tackle. Craig Faulkner with 35 receptions and a touchdown on the year, and a flag is down. A gain of 11 yards. They may bring it back. Pickens, by the way, in the first quarter had 4 receptions for 49 yards. Kelly, 8 of 14 through the air for 117 yards passing.
We have holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty. still first down.
Interesting in the collegiate game, instead of the line of scrimmage, it goes from the spot of the foul. So we're going to have first down and approximately 24.
Total loss of the penalty yardage, 14 yards. First and 24 at the Tennessee 40.
And Kelly back to throw it. Good protection. Drops it over the middle to the tight end, Mark Adams. And Adams is stopped by Darren Perry.
You know, Darren Perry, that was an excellent tackle. Of course, the strong safety for Penn State is known as the hero back. When I questioned Jerry Sandusky where that number came from, he said that Rip Engel, the coach, of course, a legendary coach for Penn State prior to Joe Paterno, everybody else was calling that position a monster back, and he didn't like that term monster. And so he said, I wanted something that was a little more, had a little more flair, a little more drama to it. And so the strong safety for Penn State's known as the hero.
Tennessee leading 10-7. Play action. Rolling left is Kelly. All the time in the world. Now he gets pressure. Throws back right into coverage, and it is incomplete. Did he catch it? It was Stewart along the sideline, and he caught it over the shoulder of a defender. And it'll go for 10.
The misdirection, the counter boot is what this is. He fakes the counter, comes back, and look at all the time that Kelly is going to have. Fakes to Stewart on the counter. Great blocking up front. He rolls out all sorts of time. This is about his fourth read coming back, and Gauguinus has as good a protection coverage as you can right here, but he doesn't look back. And as a result, Stewart's able to go over the top of his head and make a very good catch.
And so the ball now at the Penn State 46-yard line. And it is third down and 10. Pushed down to McCluskey at the 33-yard line of Penn State. J.J. McCluskey from Knoxville, and a gain of 13.
This is a nice job. What they do, they isolate him on Humphreys. Three wide receivers to the right, one to the left. He has the hook pattern. It's up to Humphreys. Can he make the play or not? And in that case, the two number sixes, the orange one wins.
And speaking of Knoxville, the legendary broadcaster Lindsey Nelson at home watching the ball game and enjoying, of course, the offense of Tennessee.
It was nice to know to lend one of his jackets to Johnny Majors.
Yeah. Stewart, the ball carrier.
Used to love to look at those sports jackets. That would wake you up, no matter how early that game was.
Be sure to stay with us all day New Year's Day here on NBC. Championship Wednesday concludes with a primetime showdown. And, of course, following the fireworks of Tennessee, this is Pickens down the sideline, and he is out at the 20-yard line. Bonner got him.
Once again, I often wonder what the situation is here. You can't tell me that this is your best guy and then isolate him on people that are secondary people. That man right there is arguably the best wide receiver in the NCAA, and take a look at the number of first rounders. He will follow this group. First round receivers from Tennessee in the National Football League. That's an impressive list, and that man is next.
And in the ballgame, five receptions for 58 yards and a first down at the Penn State 20-yard line. And this one is incomplete. Pickens, the intended receiver. Reuben was there, and it'll be second and 10.
Having been a wide receiver, oftentimes you feel like you can style and come with a one-hander. I think he had enough room to extend both hands. Comes back to the left. Let's see. Yeah. He didn't come up with the right hand. He tried to one-hand it, and Reuben does a nice job of having him by the legs. He looks for the call, but there's none coming.
Was there contact where the ball got there?
Incidental. Good play by number 39.
Second and 10, 20-yard line. Tennessee leads by 3, 10-7. We're a couple of minutes into the second quarter. And it is incomplete. Corey Fleming, the intended receiver, and it's going to be third down and 10. Still at the 20-yard line. In the Peach Bowl, East Carolina, the winner, 37-34. Hall of Fame Bowl, Syracuse over Ohio State, 24-17. Citrus, California, 37, Clemson, 13. In the Cotton Bowl, Florida State, 10, Texas A&M, 2. And no score in the Rose Bowl. Charlie rolls, throws into the corner. It is Faulkner who was there going for it. And it is incomplete. We'll bring it back.
Now, Penn State's doing a good job of getting some rush on Kelly. Far too way out. Good call by the official. But really, the key to that is forcing Kelly out of the pocket and making him throw on the run. Penn State finally getting a little rush.
And so Bexford, who has hit from 24 yards out, will attempt a 37-yard field goal. Again, Martin to center, Julian to hold, and Bexford from 37. And it is no good. He misses wide to the right from the 30 for 37 yards away. Tennessee still leads by three.
Sacka's numbers and then.
This happened before the ball game, the Army parachute team. And they came in, the band was still, they had to go right into the corner of the end zone. And it was a very impressive landing. 12:44, time remaining in the first half. Tennessee leading Penn State by three, 10-7. And Penn State has the ball at their own 20-yard line, first down. In first downs, Tennessee has 13. Penn State has only one. And going over the top is Richie Anderson. And he's going to pick up a couple of yards to the 22. Todd Kelly making the stop. He along with Bailey and Casey Rogers are in that defensive set for Tennessee.
Well, Tony Sacka, offensive coordinator Fran Gander, told us that that man right there is the most talented quarterback they have ever had at Penn State, and certainly the numbers justify that. All-time leader in career yardage, as you saw by that graphic this year, has been the most prolific offensively for Penn State in their history.
But as you can see, struggling in this game, 1 of 5 for 10 yards. This is their second completion. This is to O.J. McDuffie, and he has the first down. Out to the 34-yard line. A gain of 11. Sean Walker with the tackle. First down, Penn State.
Well, with Terry Smith on the shelf with a shoulder injury, the onus of the passing game really does fall here to O.J. McDuffie. Little move right here, and he actually avoids two people who overrun it. A good hustle there on the part of the middle backer, Walker, to catch him from behind. O.J. McDuffie having a terrific year himself. 46 catches for 790 yards and 6 touchdowns. Also, he has returned 2 punts for touchdowns.
And Penn State comes back on the ground with Richie Anderson, the ball carrier.
This is really what they have to do, Charlie. You know, the way Penn State was going up and down the field, of course, it could be time to panic. But you look up at the scoreboard and you realize it's only 10-7. There's plenty of time left in this game. Penn State needs to establish the run with Anderson, mix it up a little bit with some play-action passes, and not go to the straight drop back on first down every time.
The ball at the 39-yard line of Penn State. And it is second down and 5. Sacka taking a lot of time. Now his pressure rolls out to the right. And he's going to step out just around the 35-yard line. So he's going to lose 4 on the play. It'll be 3rd down and 9. As he was being chased by Sean Walker.
The one drawback of Sacka, as witnessed by both the offensive coordinator and Joe Paterno, was to admit to the fact that he's not the niftiest guy in the world at 6'5" and 225 pounds. And later we'll get a shot of the shoes that he's wearing, and maybe that's one of the reasons. Get a chance to see. This is my description. I'm telestrating these shoes that Sacka wears right there.
And if you want a second opinion, they're slow.
Man, those look like gravity boots.
3rd down and 9. Sacka has pressure. And he throws downfield, and it is incomplete. Bobby Engram, the intended receiver, will be 4th down.
Well, you can hear the cheer of the Tennessee faithful. It looked like Penn State might have had something going there with the 1st down to McDuffie, but Tennessee strengthened and pursuing Sacka all over the field, making him throw, going to his left. All he could do was throw the ball away. And now Penn State has to punt.
And Doug Helkowski will be kicking to Dale Carter, the ever-dangerous return man.
Bob Check is the center for Penn State. No rush, good kick. Carter drops back, takes it at the 16, drops it, fumbles it again, picks it up at the 11. He's now at the 10. And struggles back to the 19-yard line. So Tennessee has the ball and the lead.
You can't use the excuse of the sun because now it's going a different direction. He kind of goes side saddle like a center fielder trying to shield himself. But twice he isn't able to pick it up, and he's not able to give them the field position that they would have liked.
Tennessee 10, Penn State 7.
Oftentimes when you goof up, first time you say shame on you, second time shame on me. Everybody was comforting Dale Carter the first time, not this time. You can see Johnny Majors not very happy with his All-American free safety. Little chewing out here to say, how can you make that mistake? That was a very heated argument. You can see by the look on his face, not happy with the way Dale Carter handled himself on that last punt.
Tennessee has the ball, first down at their own 19-yard line. They lead in the ballgame 10-7. And Aaron Hayden makes his first appearance in offense, and he has 5 to the 25, 6 to the 25, right with the tackle. Let's go down to Ahmad.
All right, Charlie, here I've found a very good friend of mine. This is Woody. Actually, it's Smokey. See, the other Smokey they had, he passed away this last year, so Woody is sitting in for him here. He's got Smokey on the side, but he's a good old dog. He's a blue tick hound, and you know, Smokey
Ahmad,
might just go hunt the fish.
Ahmad, do you know who's behind you?
Who's that behind you?
And Hayden is cut down by Bonner.
Been picking on Bonner in the passing game, but he comes up and makes a nice tackle there.
I think they were picking on Ahmad down there is what I think they were doing.
Coming off the block here, watch Bonner makes the play. Cutting to the outside, that's actually a bad cut by the youngster. He should have cut inside for the yardage, but that enabled Bonner to make the play. I'm very surprised, quite frankly, that Hayden's in the game, as well as Stewart was running in the first quarter.
But they want to keep fresh legs.
He's 19, for goodness sake. He's fresh legs.
Here's the reason Hayden is in, as he picks up the first down. 9 yards to the 35-yard line. Aaron Hayden, a freshman from Detroit, 6 feet even, 200 pounds. Bonner and Wright with the tackle.
Once again, the interior line. Take a look off the ball. Fisher and Mislinski open up the big hole. And Hayden's able to slide through. Brett Wright unable. He comes back and helps on the tackle, but not before Hayden has gotten the first down.
And number 50, the left guard, Tom Mislinski, will tell you about the way his name is pronounced right after this play. Here is Hayden. He goes out to the 40-yard line. When we talked to number 50, Tom Mislinski, a couple of days ago, we asked him how does he pronounce his name, and he said, everybody's been calling me Mize. He said, but it's Miss. He said, Mislinski. He said, of course, if my friends in Rome, New York, where I'm from, if you call it Mislinski, they'll really like it.
Let me tell you something. I bet that if they continue to run the ball the way they're running it, the Penn State linebackers will be able to pronounce his name correctly.
Yes. Second down and 5. Hayden with the last 4 carries in a row, now 5 in a row. And he is brought down at the 41-yard line, so it's going to be 3rd down and 4. As Rivati and Gogena stop the Tennessee offense. And we have an injury timeout. And that is Bernard Dapney, the left tackle, the senior from Los Angeles. So we'll step aside for a moment. Tennessee leads 10-7. Third down and 4. And Hayden is going to be stopped at the 43-yard line, so he's going to get only 2. It'll be 4th down and a couple, and Tennessee will be kicking, and it was Jim Dieter who made the stop.
Well, that's big for Penn State. Counter Trey, standard play, started with Nebraska, made famous by the Washington Redskins, but Jim Dieter, the nose guard, penetrates, makes the play, forces Tennessee to punt.
Tom Hutton will be kicking. This is his first punt of the ball game. You may recall that Andy Kelly with that little pooch kick earlier in the game, and O.J. McDuffie is the return man for Penn State. And a left-footed walk-on freshman kicker. And a good return for O.J., named by his grandmother for O.J. Simpson. 36 yards on the kick, a 12-yard return. And Reggie Ingram makes the tackle.
Well, that's too bad. He ran into Brett Wright, his own man, or else he'd have had even more yardage. He cuts to the inside, hits number 47 in a white jersey. Otherwise, because of the low punt, he had a head of steam going. Watch him cut up the middle with a low punt. They're not down as quickly. He evades the first down. Now watch him run right into number 47. If you get a cut to the left, you can see there's nothing but grass ahead of him.
Penn State first down the ball just shy of their 30-yard line, 35-yard line. And Sam Gash, who has scored Penn State's only touchdown, is the ball carrier, and he's going to pick up a yard, maybe two on the play. It'll be second down as Fields and Kelly make the tackle. And we'll be playoff.
I think, Charlie, the people shouldn't be already mailing the AFC Championship trophy to Buffalo. I think that those teams are going to be very competitive with them.
Here is the screen to Anderson, and he picks up the first down. A flag is down back at the 36-yard line.
Well, I think Penn State was able to draw Tennessee offside, so they'll certainly let this one go.
A gain of 11 yards on the play, the first down if it stands. Floyd Miley with the tackle.
Offsides on the defense. The penalty's declined.
Dale Phillips, the referee, heading up our officiating crew from the ACC that have 184 years of experience. They have worked 29 ball games coming into this one.
Sackett does a good job of keeping his head steady. Oftentimes, the referee might call the quarterback for that and changing his cadence and moving his head, but he didn't do that. Anderson on the screen, able to take some people with him. Gets the first down for the Nittany Lions.
Just outside the 48-yard line, their own side of the 50. 6.5 minutes time remaining in the first half. Penn State trailing by three. Sam Gash is nothing there. We talk about the Tennessee offense. Well, their defense has completely shut down Penn State.
Well, Casey Rogers was able to get the penetration there. Again, the struggling offensive line of Penn State. Trying to get the running game going right in the middle. There's nobody there. Nobody even touches him. And he's followed by about four or five other orange shirts, which indicates the fact that the offensive line is not doing the job.
Number 99, Casey Rogers for Tennessee, was there. Penn State rushing, 12 carries, a total of 8 yards. 8 yards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's it. Shaka goes deep, and it is incomplete. He was going to McDuffie. And Jeremy Lincoln had picked him up on the coverage. It's going to be third down.
Tennessee is mixing up its coverage. It came with a blitz there, and they had man for man. But McDuffie was covered. That's a good job by the secondary. His ball coming right towards you, and I do mean right towards you.
Ahmad was there. The report that we have is that he still has the hands, but he heard some footsteps.
Ahmad could have caught it. He just stepped out of bounds, just like he always did.
Sack of 3 of 9, 32 yards in the touchdown.
Cold shot. Cold shot.
Jack's pass is incomplete. And it will be fourth down. Here at the Fiesta Bowl with 5 minutes and 40 seconds left to go in the first half. Penn State scoring first on a 10-yard pass, and that followed Jeff Kerwin's fumble recovery of the opening kickoff to Dale Carter, and then Stewart scored for Tennessee. They added the field goal. It's 10-7. Tennessee over Penn State, and this one will be allowed to go into the end zone for the touchback. We'll bring it out to the 20-yard line. It's a 52-yard kick. We'll step aside for just a moment. Time remaining first half. Tennessee leads 10-7. This is Charlie Jones, Todd Christensen, and Ahmad Rashad. The Tennessee on offense starting from their own 20-yard line. James Littleman Stewart, who has scored the touchdown for Tennessee, is back in the ballgame. The report on Bernard Daphne, who was injured a moment ago, it's a sprained ankle. He's had it before. He's got it again. He can return right now. Rodney Gordon has replaced him at that spot. And Kelly rolls and throws, and the pass is complete far side to Craig Faulkner near the first down markers. Be about a yard shy. It's going to be second down and one at the 29.
Tennessee has been making a habit here, this misdirection play action. Faulkner cuts up the field, looks like he's going out and up, and all of a sudden comes back quickly. And why is a linebacker at number 58 on a wing back? That is certainly a mismatch, and Kelly does a nice job of finding it there in the secondary.
Second down and one at the 29-yard line. This Tennessee offense has been virtually unstoppable by Penn State in the first half. And here is Mario Brunson. He's going to get a couple of yards. More importantly, from Tennessee North, Stewart. He is going to pick up the first down at the 31-yard line. Dioka Jackson with the tackle.
Kelly already thrown the ball 21 times for 162 yards. Give credit to his offensive line. They've done an outstanding job of protecting him thus far.
Kenneth Campbell is the fullback. Stewart is now the tailback in his offensive set. A little fake to a pitch out. Kelly comes back, goes deep into double coverage. It's caught by Pickens.
Oh, what a throw.
And what a catch by Pickens in traffic.
Well, now you can see the reaction of Pickens. He got himself a gift. Andy Kelly just put a laser beam right on his hands. This is actually excellent coverage. And you can see by that smile on his face, he knew he got one. Looks back to the left. Pickens all alone. Look at the coverage here. Bond is right there with him. Reuben comes over to help. Look at where the ball is. Right on his hands. What a terrific throw by Andy Kelly.
And again, a 28 yards to the Penn State 21-yard line. The second back through is Stewart to the 35. He picks up six. It'll be second down and four. And it was Reggie Gibbons with the tackle.
You know, very rarely do you see a situation where guys are as good as advertised, but that man certainly is. He's having himself a day.
And meanwhile, James Stewart, with 12 carries, has picked up 74 yards and has scored Tennessee's touchdown. And here it is, second down. Again, a play action fake. Pickett stops, comes back, and it is incomplete. Battling with Humphreys at the 1 yard line, it'll be third down.
And finally, we have Humphreys on Pickens. Finally, the good cover man is on their best receiver, and he had him blanketed. This is one of those classic cases where the ball is overthrown. Humphreys right with him, step for step. He comes back. Now watch the hand right at the end there. Nice job by Humphreys, putting his hand right between the two arms of Pickens.
And what?
Excellent coverage by Humphreys.
Humphreys told us yesterday that he has a knack for picking up the ball in the air. He can follow the receiver with his head and look back and just pick it out immediately.
Well,
he's always had that knack.
Right there, that was a fantastic job, because once the ball is overthrown, he's running the other direction. He has to make a great athletic play to come back, and that's just what he did.
Over the middle, Pickens pulls it down. 25-yard line, gain of 10, first down. And Johnny Majors, the head coach of Tennessee, talked about Carl Pickens and the fact that he's foregoing his last year for the NFL draft.
I could understand if he didn't stay another year, because that's significant. A young man could get hurt. You can't afford to talk him out of it because of that. Economically, many of them need it. And last, and certainly not the least, I understand that the laws of the land, I don't think we could win a court case but try to prevent some young men from going to the pros. So that's facts. We have to face it and try to be as fair to the young men as you can. Carl's done a good job for us, and we wish him Godspeed.
The ball carrier is Bose Phillips, also a freshman, the third freshman tailback for Tennessee that we have seen in the ballgame. Perry and Reuben with the tackle. Back to what Johnny Majors was saying, another factor to put together with Pickens is this is his postseason. Since he's a junior, he's not going to be participating in the bowl games, the Hula Bowl games, the chance to star and show off for the scouts. This is it.
Well, I think it's very interesting that Johnny Majors comes across as very magnanimous there, but he does input the whole idea of, well, we couldn't fight it in court anyway. Yeah, okay.
Pickens, 7 receptions, 97 yards, and we have just under 3 minutes. The time remaining in the first half is Kelly just kind of struggles to the 20-yard line. There's the time remaining, 2:46 and counting.
Neither of these quarterbacks are going to make anybody forget Steve Young or Randall Cunningham. That was a straight quarterback draw, and Andy Kelly, certainly not an option quarterback or much of a runner, was able just to salvage a yard on that one.
Yeah, but what a nice young man. You know, when we talked to him a couple of days ago,
And he was saying, well, you know, we messed up a lot during the season. He said, but mostly it was my fault. He said, I would do a misread or that. And then his coaches said, he might mess up, but he always had that knack of coming back and doing it again.
He's doing okay today.
I would say he is. 15 of 24, 201 yards already. And here is Pickens again. And Perry with the tackle.
I'll be interested in this decision right now because the freshman kicker missed from about this distance last time. This will be a little bit shorter. It'll be about a 35-yarder, but they've got fourth and two, and you can see right there, Majors is debating it himself as to what he wants to do. Coming into the game, Becksport was 15 of 21, but Majors is going to call timeout and give him a chance to think about it.
Clock is stopped with 1:49. Time remaining in the first half. We'll be back in a moment. 49, time remaining in the first half. It's Tennessee 10, Penn State 7. Becksport, the kicker for Tennessee, has hit from 24, missed from 37, so they decide not to take a chance here. It's fourth down and a couple. Tyoka Jackson and Lou Benfati and Keith Gogena. And Penn State takes over on downs, but during that drive,
I'll be interested here, Charlie, when he goes to the sidelines, what his coach talks with him about or if he gets chewed out. It looked for all intents and purposes like Andy Kelly audibled on that play there at the line of scrimmage. And you didn't give yourself much of a chance on fourth and two by just handing the ball to the tailback, a third string tailback at that, on a fourth down crucial play. I'm very surprised at that.
But to finish out my thought on the drive for Tennessee, Carl Pickens now has run his total in the first half to 8 receptions, 100 yards receiving. Penn State from their own 18-yard line. They have a first down, and Richie Anderson is swarmed under by Tennessee. Bailey and Fuller making the tackle. Poor Tennessee's defense has just shut them off.
Well, and it also shows that right now Tennessee should be using its timeouts, because I think that Penn State is going to be content just to let the clock run out, being totally outgained in the first half and still only being down by a field goal. I'm surprised right now Johnny Majors isn't using them. I think maybe after this down, they're going to use a timeout, assuming that Penn State runs the ball.
Second down and 11, a loss back to the 17-yard line. Anderson dropped by Field. And another loss. It will be third down. That's Ernest Fields, the linebacker.
Well, Penn State actually gets a break here because of the official timeout. You can see that Fields, their leading tackler with 116 tackles, able to penetrate right there. And actually, one of his men just came by and caught him on the left leg. Oh, that's too bad. That was a fluke play. If we get a chance to see that again, John McDonough, our director, at the end of the play, when he makes the tackle, his own man is going to come by and flick his left leg. Take a look. The pursuit comes by Chuck Smith. Watch that left leg. Right there. That's a hyperflexion of the left knee. I can attest to that because I had one personally. And that's what it is. That's a hyperflexion. Watch the left leg. Watch his left knee. Now watch it get flexed over right there. Ouch. Just get bumped in there. It's flexed a little bit too far. It's either a quadricep or a medial collateral of the knee. Ernest Fields, as I mentioned, their leading tackler this year with 116 tackles against Notre Dame in that great comeback game where they won 35-34. He had 15 tackles against the Golden Domers. Really a nice man, too.
Penn State's last five possessions, punt. Three and out.
Deontay just said he's all right.
And right now, Charlie, they'll be fortunate just to do that. They've had two running plays, and they've got a net of minus 5 yards.
Third down and 14.
Maybe right half time. We'll get him.
Anderson for the first down. It was third and 14 across the 30. Dale Carter with the tackle. And Penn State has the first down.
Aren't you a little surprised there on these last two plays why Johnny Majors didn't call a timeout? Deep in their own territory down there, they could have forced him to punt, get it in midfield, and at least get into field goal position?
I was surprised. Now Penn State has called for a timeout. Are you surprised with that?
No, I feel like now that they figure that they're within 40, 45 yards of getting in field goal position, but Saka hasn't exactly had the hot hand. I think that Penn State should be content just to run the clock out the way things have been going, regroup a little bit at halftime and come out, because they're going to receive the kickoff as a result of deferring in the first half.
Unofficially, at this point in the ballgame, total offense for Tennessee, 324 yards. 324 yards. For Penn State, 51 yards.
Here's a bit more significant statistic, however.
More than that one?
Yes.
And there's only a three-point difference.
Tennessee 10, Penn State 7. Yeah. That's all that matters.
That's right.
We heard it from Irma Bombeck herself. Yeah, and right. If anybody knows about football, it's Irma Bombeck, all right? She said the team with the most points wins.
That's right. She has it covered.
That's it.
And we talked with Joe Paterno. I asked him, you know, how much longer do you want to coach? And he said, till I'm 70. That's another 5 years. He said, it may be longer. So I talked to my assistants. They'll tell me when I've lost it. No joke.
No, they won't.
No, they won't.
They will not.
I got to tell you, Joe.
Absolutely not.
First down at the 32-yard line. Saka has pressure, steps away, steps back. Little kind of shovel pass to Drayton. Miley was there for the defense. We've got 15 seconds left in the first half.
This is where Fran Gantner, the offensive coordinator, really has to think about it. You can see him right there standing next to Saka, kind of rolling his eyes, the man with the headset with the right earphone up on top of his right ear. You know, with 25 seconds left and the way they've been rushing the passer, he's really taking a risk trying to do this, because in all likelihood, they're going to have a really difficult time getting into field goal position unless they just throw a long pass and get lucky. I think at this point they should just kneel down and get the half over with.
What camera will I have, T.R.?
Second down and two. The ball just shy of the 40-yard line. Saka throws. Pass is complete at the 49-yard line. Drayton pulls it in. And a first down and a timeout. Of course, coming up this afternoon, the Orange Bowl to follow the Fiesta Bowl. Miami, as you see, of course, in the AP rankings, right in the seed, number 11. You're watching Penn State, the sixth-ranked team, challenging Tennessee, the 10th, and Tennessee is getting all of the best of it in the first half. 10-7 with 9 seconds left to go in the first half.
Speaking of Paul, I liked his New Year's resolution regarding moderation. I thought that was a very cogent thought.
All things in moderation. And glad that he is healthy and back with us. Saka with that pressure. The pressure from Chuck Smith and Chris Mims and Todd Kelly has been constant. And Chuck Smith told us that he was going to get, he said, I'll get a sack, I'll go over and I'll talk to Ahmad on the sideline. He said, if he doesn't talk to me, I'll go back and I'll get another one, then I'll come talk to him.
Well, somebody who's going to have to do some serious coaching here in the second half is Coach Anderson of the Penn State Nittany Lions. The offensive line has just struggled. Whatever it is they've attempted to do with the stunts of Tennessee, it just has not worked, and Saka has been spending the whole time running for his life.
Second down and 22, the ball at the 37-yard line with 2 seconds left to go in the first half.
It's an interesting conversation. You can see the hands go up on the part of Fran Gantner, offensive coordinator, to Joe Paterno, say, hey, we're doing what we can, but this isn't happening right now.
Three wide receivers for Penn State. Here is the draw, and there's nothing there. Bradley and Kelly with the tackle as the first half comes to a close. Tennessee 10, Penn State 7. Total offense, first half, 324 yards for Tennessee, a total of only 59 for Penn State. The margin, though, is only 3.
But the look on that man's face says it all. Yeah, he knows that we're running up a lot of yards.
Let's go down to Ahmad.
All right, Charlie. Coach, now, you were a little concerned about the Penn State offense, but your defense has shut them down the first half.
Well,
Well, Mott, I'm very pleased with the way our entire football team is playing, except for a couple of aspects. One of them, we've looked a little sloppy on the punting game a little bit. Return, I should say the punting return. And a fumble, a kickoff, the opening kickoff. That cost us possession, also 7 points. And not getting the ball in the end zone. I'm pleased with the offense moving the ball. We're not getting in the end zone, and our kicking game looks a little bit sloppy.
All right, Coach, good luck to you in the second half.
I hope so.
You would never
Back
know
to you,
that
Charlie.
He was... Thank you, man. You'd never know he was leading. All right. It's 10-7 here at the Fiesta Bowl. Let's go back to New York City and Gail Gardner. Gail?
All right, Charlie, thank you very much. We're back on Championship Wednesday here with Paul McGuire, Fiesta Bowl. We're going to take a quick look, first of all, at the first half highlights, and there weren't too many of those. This is the opening kickoff, which comes down to Tennessee's Dale Carter quarter. Tennessee's freshman tailback, James Stewart, over the top. That ties the game at 7. They added a field goal, the 37-yard field goal by John Becksport, Tennessee did, and that makes it 10-7 Tennessee that game at the half. And I got to tell you, Penn State, having a lousy first half, is lucky to be in this one at all.
But you've got to think about something, and I think Todd Christensen hit it on the head. It doesn't make any difference that Tennessee has over 300 yards, and Penn State only has 59. They're only out of it by 3. Joe Paterno is probably the best halftime coach in all of college football. And if any team has a chance, as badly as they're playing, it's Penn State.
When you say that, when you make a statement like that, what do you mean? What are the kinds of things that he does at the half to energize the team?
Well, he doesn't have to energize them. What he will do now is go to his coaching staff, and they will adjust. Mm-hmm. They will make the offense and defensive adjustments that they have to make in order to come back and beat Tennessee. And I think they can do it.
Okay, of course. The other big game that is taking.
All right, thank you, Gail. And now the University of Tennessee Pride of the Southland Band, directed by W.J. Julian. Take an opportunity to visit both of these great institutions, Tennessee and Penn State. In the first half, 324 yards to Penn State's 59. Now, he says we've got to suck it up and make something happen. Can Paterno do it, or can Penn State do it against this Tennessee ball club?
Well, I think they have to make some adjustments, particularly in the offensive line, and as I said earlier, they have to get the running game established, and certainly Tony Saka can't have 5-for-12 numbers. Andy Kelly's just rolling it up. You know, it's interesting. Tennessee coming into this game was averaging 468 yards in offense, and that's exactly what they're going to do. But Penn State was averaging 421 yards in offense, and they're a long ways off of that. So,
but I'm not sure that anybody everybody's talked about Tennessee's defense as well as they're playing today, I think that they'll be talking about them for quite a while.
Well, certainly their quickness has a lot to do with the fact that they've been able to get to Saka, but what I'm surprised at is their ability to stuff the run because they're a smaller defense.
Yeah, they are. All right, now let's take a look at the official halftime statistics. The numbers that we were talking about are the ones, of course, that just jump out at you. First down, 5, 16 for Tennessee. Rushing yardage, 10 for Penn State, 120 for Tennessee. Passing yards, 49. 204. That one turnover.
Time of possession. I was going to say, though, that one turnover is big because, of course, that was the opening kickoff fumble, and that enabled Penn State to get their lone touchdown here.
That fumble was recovered by Jeff Kerwin, and Penn State went in from 11 yards away for their only touchdown, and since then, and you wondered if this was at that moment in time, you wondered if, hey, all of a sudden this is a Penn State afternoon. Didn't seem to bother Tennessee at all. They just came back and took over the ball game.
No, it really didn't. Give credit to that man right there, Johnny Majors. And this man, I was going to say, Johnny Majors has done a good job psychologically with his team because it could have been very easy to panic there early on, but they did the exact opposite. And now it's up to Joe Paterno, his opposite number on the other side of the field, to get his troops going. To realize that, yeah, we played very poorly, as he mentioned, in the first half. But as you can see by that graphic, usually he has the right things to say at halftime because they have outscored their opponents 102-24 in the third stanza.
Penn State in the final NCAA statistics ranked 9th in defense. Tennessee ranked 13th. And it's been a lucky 13 so far. Tennessee will be kicking off to open the second half with Hammonds and Morris, the two return men. And here is JT Morris on the return. And he is decked at the 16-yard line. And it was David Bennett who got it. How important is first offensive series for Penn State?
Well, I don't know if I could put it on the Richter scale, but if the scale is 1 to 10, I'd have to say this has got to be about a 7. I mean, they have to get something going because the way the Tennessee offense has been going, the only time they've been stopped is by themselves, by a drop pass that led to a field goal, a missed field goal, and then the big goal line stand on 4th and 2 at the end of the first half. So Penn State doesn't want to give them the ball back, 3 and 5.
And here is Sam Gash, the fullback, carries to the 22-yard line. He'll pick up 5. And it's going to be 2nd down and 5 as Sean Walker makes the tackle. On a 1 to 10 Richter scale, I would think from Penn State stand, this side that this could reach almost a 9. I mean, they've got to do it here to get anything going.
Well, see, now you're the master of the overstatement. Wait a minute, it's just the beginning of the third quarter. You said earlier your eyes deceived you.
Yes.
Come on.
And now my logic deceived
you. It's not Armageddon just yet.
Tell me what it is. And it is incomplete to McDuffie. Daryl Hardy for the defense. 3rd down and 5.
OJ McDuffie tried to make the move before he had the ball. Gonna hit him right in the chest. He wants to make the quick move and avoid the defensive back. And right there, see his look. Takes his eyes off the ball and drops it. Not real happy with himself.
Jackson now 5 of 13 for 49 yards. He does have the touchdown throw. It'll be 4th down.
Notice here, even though that they did not get the sack, Tennessee is making Saka hurry his throws. You can see right there he's not happy with himself, but he takes his 3-step drop and really throws before he's ready. Watch how quickly he throws the ball before McDuffie even looks. Quickly, he short arms a little bit, and up in the air to bat it down was Ernest Fields, having another tremendous game on defense for the Volunteers.
Doug Helkowski will be kicking. Dale Carter is the return man. Good kick. Carter backpedals to the 24. A right return on as a couple of blocks. And it's spun down at the 32, maybe the 33-yard line by Brian Mosier. 53 yards on the kick, 7 yards on the return as we look down from the MetLife blimp, flying at an altitude of 1,200 feet to bring you these shots here at Sun Devil Stadium. So Penn State starts the second half where they ended the first half. They were unable to get any offense going. And Tennessee, with their first offensive possession of the second half, at their own 32-yard line. Tennessee up only by 3, 10-7.
Now, if Tennessee drives the length of the field and scores, I'll come back to you and say you were right when you said it was a 9 on the Richter scale.
Kelly's pass is complete to Faulkner. At the 40-yard line, a gain of 8. It'll be second down and a couple. Darren Perry had the coverage.
Because of Carl Pickens, Faulkner doesn't really get the notoriety that he deserves. Kind of a possession-type receiver. Once again, the out-and-up move comes back to the ball. This is actually a good catch. Look at his body going a different direction. Kind of an Elgin Baylor move there with body control midair to come back and make the catch.
He told me, though, he does not like to be called a possession-type. I'm a quick-speed receiver.
Yeah, right. Okay. That makes you happy, Craig.
A gain of a yard. It'll be third down and 1. James Stewart, the ball carrier. Gorgonis with the tackle.
Well, I was going to say, we saw the graphic there at 5'11", 180. Nobody's going to accuse him of being a bruiser.
That's right. Stewart, by the way, in the first half, 12 carries, rushed for 74 yards and the touchdown. Daphne's still walking it off. 41-yard line. Third down and 1. Mario Brunson. And he needed a yard, and that's about all that he got. They'll bring the chains out for the measurement.
Of course, this is hindsight, but that would have been a great time for a play-action pass. They had Bonham man-for-man on Pickens to the left. And 60 yards of field, that would have been a good chance, good time to take a chance with one.
Clarence. Johnny Majors, the head coach of Tennessee. Boy, what a great tailback, triple threat he was at Tennessee. As we mentioned in the tease, a runner-up to the Heisman Trophy to Paul Hornung.
Did you see that picture of him with the flat top there?
Yeah, you like that?
No, I didn't. But I just asked if you saw it.
Yeah, I did. Well, it's not all that long now.
No, I just, that was the haircut of the day. That's fine.
First down, Tennessee, their own 42-yard line.
It was easier to fit the leather helmet on, I think.
That is true.
With the flat top.
Yeah, no question about it.
All right.
Kind of form-fitting.
Yeah.
Play action. Flag is down. May have a face mask call as Kelly was spinning away.
Yeah, that's really unfortunate on the part of Reggie Givens, because I think Rich McKenzie would have had the sack anyway. Incidental face mask, and that's really going to hurt Penn State because they finally had him for a big loss.
I guess the defense, 5-yard penalty.
On number 58, Reggie Givens.
Here's one of the adjustments that Jerry Sandusky makes as a defensive coordinator. They've been doing the misdirection. Now, instead of honoring the fake, you can see Givens heads right for the quarterback. And as I say, had he not had the face mask, McKenzie was there for the sack anyway. It's really a bad break for Penn State there.
I was sitting next to Joe Paterno at the kickoff luncheon, and when the two head coaches were introduced, he got a little bit more applause than Johnny Majors, and I said on the applause meter, you're ahead, and he said, so far, so good.
Yeah, except for, you know what, Johnny Majors got him back in his speech when he was talking. He said, you know, young coaches like myself would like to thank Joe Paterno.
Yeah, right.
He nailed him with that one. That was pretty good. Paterno had to laugh.
Bowl games and victory.
You see right there, the 22nd bowl appearance for Joe Paterno. That's second only to Bear Bryant, who had 29.
First down and 5. Here is James Stewart.
Stewart carries.
And he is cut down at the 50, gain of 3, so it's going to be second down. And still a couple to go for the first down.
Good open field tackle there by Leonard Humphreys. When we talked with the defensive coordinator, Jerry Sandusky, we asked him about some of the people with pro potential. And he said that except for this man's size, he said, this guy could be a professional cornerback. And, you know, I wanted to tell him, I said, hey, you know, Charlie and I have been around some Smurfs around this league.
Yeah.
I mean, especially at Houston, when you got guys like Tony Jones who weigh 136 pounds, size isn't that much of an issue anymore.
Here is Stewart. And he is going to pick up the first down. That face mask penalty we had a moment ago is only the third penalty of the game and the first against Penn State.
This is often what happens with a young runner. He puts his head down and he's not exactly sure where he wants to go. They say, you know, he wants to get the first down, but take a look. Are there any Penn State tacklers here? Watch him lower his shoulder and actually run into his own man there. And again, look right there. He doesn't have his head up, and so he runs into the reserve tackle for the Volunteers. Rodney Gordon, if he had his head up, he'd had a... had a few more yards.
And the toss a little too tall for Carl Pickens. It is incomplete. Perry part of that defensive coverage, and Bonfanti was putting the pressure on Andy Kelly.
Well, you can see that Stewart has more yards than the entire Penn State offense. Every time I see these graphics, nowadays with so many one-back offenses where that's going, you know, the guys like this are 30, 40, 50% of the offense anyway.
Touchdown.
That's the third time in the game that Penn State has been caught in that defense where they had an inside linebacker on a wide receiver. Keith Gauganis is an outstanding inside linebacker. He plays the run well, but there's absolutely no reason that he should be in man-for-man coverage with Corey Fleming. To the right of your screen, you're going to see it. Number 42 is trying to run with Corey Fleming, number 12, and he just can't do it. There's just no way he can keep up with this man. Give Andy Kelly credit for finding him in the secondary and seeing the mismatch with the inside backer.
And the extra point. We'll be back with the kickoff in a moment.
Over 200,000 dealers across the U.S. and Canada. And by Delta Airlines. We love to fly, and it shows.
Tennessee moving 68 yards in seven plays, took 3-0-2. Corey Fleming scoring the touchdowns. He has a touchdown, two receptions, and 68 yards at the 6 point.
Charlie, both of those catches have come on that coverage by Penn State when they had the inside backer on him. Tennessee's done a good job of taking advantage of that.
Here is J.T. Morris on the return for Penn State. Across the 20 and upended at the 30, leaves the ball on the ground, but they may rule. No, they're going to rule a fumble. No, now they change it. Pointed one way, then the other. The ground caused the fumble. Ground, of course, as you know in the rules, cannot cause a fumble.
Charlie, that's
so Penn State retains possession at the 30.
That's the second time that Dale Carter has made a touchdown-saving tackle. The bounce comes up. He's going to cut back to the middle, and there's going to be a real cavern there. But he doesn't have the O.J. McDuffie speed. And right here, you can see the ground does cause the fumble. Good call by the official.
And so Penn State has a first down at their own 30-yard line. Now trailing by 10, 17-7. With 10:47 left to go in the third, and Shaka back to throw. Bobby Engram. And they're now going to rule it incomplete.
You know what? I agree. I think he got his hands underneath it. I think Bobby Engram had the catch. Take a look here on the right of the screen. Are his hands, rather, underneath the ball?
Too much ground. Too much grass.
Well, there's an awful lot. Okay. This will be a better angle for you. Okay. Did rub the grass. His hands were underneath. Awfully close. Where's that instant replay when we need it?
Sam Gash. He is pushed back. The defense led by Shazan Bradley here at the Fiesta Bowl. 10:27 and counting. Time remaining in the third quarter. It is Tennessee 17 and Penn State 7. As Tennessee just moved 68 yards in 8 plays to stretch their 3-point margin to 10. Penn State now trying to get some offense going for them. Now at their own 33-yard line, it is third down and 7, and Joe Paterno's Penn State Nittany Lions have been shut down offensively, and the defense of Tennessee controlling the ball game, and their offense has been spectacular. And the pressure, as you can see, on Tony Saka, this time by Todd Kelly, and it will be fourth down.
Well, I don't know if the term jailbreak means anything to you, but watching the upper right of your screen, two people just get loose. That's just poor protection. There's no excuse for it. Tony Saka has got to be a frustrated quarterback. He sits back there, and all he sees is orange shirts.
Penn State worried about the defensive ends of Tennessee, and boy, they have played havoc with them. Nowakowski kicking. Carter takes it at the 15. Wants to get around the corner, does turn it, goes out of bounds. We'll step aside for a moment. It's Tennessee 17 and Penn State 7.
And 9 minutes and 42 seconds left to go in the third quarter. Tennessee having a 10-point lead. And at the beginning of halftime, Penn State came out very determined. But in the last 4 or 5 minutes, they have become very grim and very frustrated. They need to get back in this game right away. Charlie?
All right, thank you, Mike. Tennessee with the ball led by the quarterback, Andy Kelly, playing like Jim Kelly. 18 of 29 so far, has thrown for 256 yards and a touchdown. Now, Tennessee with Aaron Hayden, the ball carrier. Are they starting to work on the clock just a little bit?
No, not really. You know, I want to get back to the point on Kelly that you made. Interesting, last year at this time, during the festival, we had Louisville and Alabama, and Louisville had a quarterback by the name of Browning Nagel, who had a very, very big game, had a 300-plus passing game, and that really helped his stock with the pros. I can't help but think that the game that Andy Kelly is having against this Penn State defense has certainly got to open some scouts' eyes as to this young man's abilities.
Second down and six, the ball at the 33-yard line. Play action fake here. Reverse to Faulkner. Faulkner to the 40. To the 50-yard line. Derek Bonner got him at the 50-yard line. It'll go for 17 in the first down.
Misdirection play, Tennessee, you know, pretty standard with what they've been doing. A great time to call it. Look at that. Now watch the play that Derek Bonner makes, because right here, if he can just get blocked out, he's got orange shirts in front of him. Faulkner's got to be a little bit frustrated. Yeah, 17-yard gain, but he could have had so much more.
They're going to mark it down at the 47-yard line. Total offense now over 400 yards for Tennessee. As Hayden gets the call. Ravati and Bonna making the stop for Penn State. And a loss of a yard. It's going to be second down and 11. And don't forget, following us this afternoon, the battle this evening for the national championship, Miami Chapman, with 8 minutes left to go in the third. And Kelly's pass is dropped by the tight end, Mark Adams. Oh, and he has to be embarrassed.
Oh, he does. And he had some running room, too. Once again, isolated on an inside linebacker. I know the Penn State has great linebackers, but they're really asking them to do a lot out there. Man-for-man coverage in some situations with both wide receivers and tight end. That's just too much to ask. That's advantage Tennessee all the way.
Third down and 11. Tennessee sends five out on the pattern. The pass is incomplete. It is low to Pickens, and it will be fourth down. So Tom Hutton will come on to kick for only the second time in the ballgame.
And finally, a little cheer from the Penn State contingent, who really haven't had much to cheer about except for the first play of the game when they fumbled and they went in for the touchdown. Since that time, it's been all Tennessee.
O.J. McDuffie is the return man for Penn State.
Averaging over 10 yards of return, he had two.
It's a fake. He had pressure. He ran to the outside. And it wasn't there for Tom Hutton. So Penn State will take over at the Tennessee 42-yard line.
Well, Reggie Gibbons wasn't fooled, if indeed that was a planned play. Watch Humphreys come in and have a shot at blocking it. That's a fake all the way, because he pulled that back long before Humphreys got there, but Gibbons isn't fooled. Excellent play by Reggie Gibbons, and maybe this is the break that Penn State needs to get back in this football game. The punter, and now Penn State has good field position at the 42. Strange call.
Their second best starting field position in the ballgame, following the fumble recovery, the opening kickoff of the 11-yard line. The coverage was there, and that meant that Tony Sacca simply was throwing it away, and it'll be second down and 10 at the Tennessee 42-yard line.
Got to be frustrating on Sacca's part there. He had he had a quick play, but they had a blitz on. They had man-for-man coverage, and the man wasn't able to get up the field. You can tell by the numbers that this hasn't been his best day.
That's all kinds of strange things floating in the air. Well, what a beautiful day it is here in the Valley of the Sun. Five straight incompletions for Tony Sacken. And here is Anderson. And there's maybe a yard, and that's going to be all. Ernest Fields was there to greet him along with Chuck Smith. Third down.
One of the things that Penn State does, one of the few teams left in NCAA football that still has strong offensive linemen. What I mean by this is that when the strong side goes one direction, they flip-flop those people. Now, that's all well and good because you want your best blockers in certain positions, but that also gives the defensive people a chance to key on certain sides of the ball. And what has happened here is that Tennessee has been able to key on Penn State's running game and practically negate it.
Third down, play action fake, looking for a screen, and it is incomplete to Richie Anderson. Mim was all over Penn State. So it'll be fourth down.
Well, that's got to be frustrating for the Nittany Lions. You get exactly what you want. You get a big break. You get the fake punt. And you're able to sniff it out. Why have play action pass here, a third and 10? You know that they're going to throw the ball. Anderson just can't come up with a catch, but there was Ernest Field man for man anyway. Even if he catches the ball, he's able to snuff the play out. Tennessee making all the right guesses.
And here is Doug Helkowski.
Wow.
Look at that average. Almost 51 yards, as long as 54. And if you picked out an individual, you would almost have to say he had the best game of any of the Penn Staters.
Well, he definitely wanted to add to his average there. That wasn't even close to inside the 20-yard line.
We'll sail away to a commercial break.
Coach Dick Anderson with the offensive line of Penn State trying to get his Chargers on the same page, but I don't know, the middle of the third quarter, if you haven't been able to figure out some of the stunts by now, it might be too late.